All right. Just thinking about eating. And so the big eating day tomorrow. Eat, eat, eat. It's like I've tried not to eat way too much this week because I know Thursday's like you eat a week's worth Thanksgiving Day. But I was thinking about the blessing of the bread of the word. I was thinking about also Haley's big, you making those big, wonderful rolls? Are you gonna make those? Good. They're just yeast rolls. They're just yeast rolls. They're so yummy. Man. And you might have somebody in your family that makes wonderful bread. Well, we have a Heavenly Father that sent us bread from heaven. Jesus said, "I am the bread. I am the bread of life." And he came down from heaven, and he is, He's a living word. He's a living word. Bread, we've been doing in Chapel Day. We have been doing symbols of the word. So we've had the word of God is a light. And we had the word of God is honey. It's like honey. It's so sweet. And man, sometimes I want to do, I didn't get to do all that I studied for the kids. I just touched on it. But man, it's interesting. And honey from the rock, we mentioned that in Bible lands, how the bees were known to make honey in the crevices of the rocks. And Jesus is our rock, and there's honey in the rock. The Lord Jesus is sweet and saves us from our sin. Then we looked at seed. The Bible is seed. And we just want this incorruptible seed. And we're born again through the seed of the Word of God. And today we looked at the Bible is like bread. The Bible's like bread. But it's interesting that the New Testament is mostly Jesus is compared to bread. And Jesus is revealed through breaking of bread. He walked with the two on the road to Emmaus, and then he went in with them. When he sat with the disciples there, when he broke bread, they knew him. And he is known through the breaking of bread because he is the bread of life. And his Holy Spirit, which you can't have unless you receive Jesus. Some people that go through some experience, and there was a man I know in Lincoln that said he visited a church in Lincoln, and he said after the service, he said they sat me down in a chair. He said, "Come on, come over here." They sat me down like they were making me sit down in this chair, and then they said, "You're not going to leave here until you receive the Spirit." And he said they started putting their hands on me, and you receive the Spirit. When you receive the Lord Jesus as your Savior and you're sealed with the Spirit at that point, and you're not going to receive the Spirit without having the Lord Jesus in your heart as your Savior. It's just not going to happen. And Acts chapter 2 makes it clear that the Holy Spirit was shed forth from the Lord Jesus Christ. So, how did I get on that? It's talking about Jesus is the bread of life. And interesting that the Lord Jesus is compared to the manna because he came down from heaven. And this manna came down from heaven. And the bread that Jesus is compared to is not the bread that you baked in your oven or that anybody in Bible days baked in the oven. The bread is this bread that came down from heaven, from God. It's the manna. But you also see that this manna is compared to the word of God. And Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And it just making a comparison there of how you eat bread for your physical, you know, side, and you eat the word of God for your spiritual side. And there's just some beautiful pictures here. And we touched on this in our chapel day, talking about the word of God is bread. So just some thoughts tonight in Exodus 16. Bread of heaven for you. Bread of heaven for you. And you think that, man, all the work that goes into Thanksgiving, the Thanksgiving meal, and just, I know, Heath put a little thing on Facebook about his mother. I don't know if you saw that about his mother. He showed a picture of a dinosaur that's got his mouth wide open, and it's like, he says, my mother getting ready for Thanksgiving. And then it has this picture of this like cartoon, just all big dinosaur smile. And it's my mother when everybody arrives for Thanksgiving. It's just such a ton of work getting ready. A ton of work getting ready. Well, the Lord has prepared a feast for us. A feast for us. We can come to Him and feast every day in His Word. It satisfies our needs. It helps us. We're going to look at just some things that we can learn from manna. Some lessons we learned from the story of manna. You know, because I'm from Maine, I keep wanting to say manna. I might slip off every now and then, but it's manna. Manna. So let's pray and we'll look at. I got a whole bunch of them, but we're going to try to go fast. You know how fast I go. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful passage of Scripture and pray that you help us to understand the lessons from your word concerning manna and your word, how good your word is. Pray that your Holy Spirit would teach us and that your Holy Spirit would guide me as I preach. In Jesus' name, amen. So the story starts out. It says, and they took their journey, and life is a journey. It's a journey for the Lord. And it says from Elim, in verse 27 tells that Elim was, there were 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees. Well, they left that area. All the congregation of the children of Israel came into the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after their departing out of the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured. And notice it says the whole congregation of the children of Israel. It's like everybody complains. Everybody murmurs. It's not just your problem. It's all of our problems. We all complain. And it says, the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And as we continue down through the story, it's going to talk about how God gives them manna, bread of heaven, bread from heaven for them. And it says in verse 4, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you. And the first lesson we want to see here is the word of God keeps us from complaining. The word of God keeps us from complaining. Here they're complaining. God says, here's some manna. And it's so true for Christians that we got to keep in God's word so that we can read verses like do all things without murmurings and disputings. So we can read, let no filthy communication or corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. And the word of God keeps us from murmuring, from complaining. And so, verse 3, and the children of Israel said unto them, would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, you know, just big stews, great big stews. We just sat beside them, and you know how you like to stick your spoon in and just keep, we had it so good in Egypt when we did eat bread to the full. For ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. That's what murmuring does to you. You complain, and then you start exaggerating. You complain for so long, you start making it worse than it really is. And it makes you, you're not even thinking right anymore because you complain. But God gives his word. Secondly, the word of God keeps us from wanting to go back into Egypt. They weren't content. They're thinking, they're dreaming about how it was in Egypt. God says, I'm going to give you manna and get your mind straightened out. That's what the word of God does for us. Keeps us from worldliness. You know, somebody gets saved, and if they're not eating God's word, they're not studying God's word, being diligent in God's word, then the world's going to suck them back in, and they're going to want to go back to Egypt. Verse 4, then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you. The word of God is like rain. It's like rain. We're told that in Isaiah 55. If you look over at Isaiah 55, tell you what, Monday night, my wife has this recording, this little thing beside her bed that plays like thunderstorms or waves. You can set it. You say, I got that for you for Christmas one year. You can set waves, you know, waves crashing, or a waterfall, or... I came in Sunday night, and I thought, wow, that's a torrential downpour she's got playing on that thing. And it was the rain outside. It was just pouring. It was pouring Sunday night. And, yeah, I mean, it's just really coming down. And I think about how God says here, he will send forth his word, send forth the manna like rain. And God sends forth his word. It's the same passage here in Isaiah 55. Well, I get there where it says in verse 10, for as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. So, the word of God is like rain, that it just works. It does the purpose that God intended it to. God waters the whole earth, and God sends forth his word like rain. It was just going to rain down manna. Then, number 4, the word of God is from heaven. It's from heaven. This manna was sent down from heaven, and we don't ever want to forget it. Those that think that the Bible is just a book for man are wrong. And they get further and further wrong. And the Bible makes it clear that the manna was from heaven. And when Jesus is compared to the manna, it's just made clear he came down from heaven. And nobody else is, but Jesus came down from heaven. And he came to be our Savior. And he is the bread of life. And everybody's got to eat of him or perish. Number 5, the word of God must be sought for, labored for, must be gathered. It's got to be worked for. The word of God rained down all around the people. But God didn't put it on the table. They had to go out and gather it up. And God still says today that you've got to labor. You've got to study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. And some people think they have no clue about working to dig into God's word. Just like they think that it's just going to fall on their tables. And God says, go out and gather it up. It says in verse 4, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day. Every day you're responsible, God said, to get out there and gather up the manna. And it's work. And this whole passage, the whole chapter will keep mentioned. Like verse 16 says, gather it of every man according to his eating. And verse 18, they gathered every man according to his eating. Verse 21, they gathered. It's a got to get to work to learn God's word. And it's a work process for parents to teach their children God's word. God's word is to be labored in. It's to be studied. The word of God must be labored for. And according to the context here, it's daily. It's a daily laboring. It's not just, you know, harvest time, put it in the barn. It's there, done for. You know that every day the wife has to put the food on the table, prepare it all, and it's work. It's work. And the word of God must be labored for daily, and it reflects a day-by-day trust in the Lord, a day-by-day dependence on the Lord. Number 6, the word of God proves whether we will walk in obedience to God. The word of God proves us. The word of God proves us. Look what it says. It says in verse 4, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. So God says, you go out and gather the manna. You're going to go and get my word, seek my word, work for my word, and your attitude towards my word, whether you're going out and getting it like you're supposed to, gathering up like you're supposed to, preparing it. Numbers talks about how some of them would grind it up. Some of them would seethe it. They had different ways they would cook it. But the way you show obedience to God's word and gathering the word will prove you. It will prove you what kind of Christian you are. If you just let the word of God sit out there and you don't gather it up and it rots and it stinks because you left it there, you neglected it, then that proves you as lazy towards God's word, as not obedient towards God's word. The word will prove us. And God says, I'm giving you this manna, and I'm telling you to go gather it up, and it's going to prove you. And it sure does. It sure does. You see Christians that love the Lord, that are serving the Lord, and, you know, they're talking about the Bible. I read this passage. I studied this out. I know this doctrine. I'm standing on this doctrine. And then it just proves that they love the Lord and they're establishing the faith. But then you find that they don't even read their Bible. And it just falls through. It proves them. Probably they don't go to church, but when they feel like it, and that's not very often, and so on. The word of God proves us. And Next point here, number seven. Number seven, the word of God must be mixed with faith and obedience. The word of God must be mixed with faith and obedience. Look at number five, verse five here. And it shall come to pass that on the sixth day, they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it shall be twice as much as they gather daily. What's that talking about? Well, as you read down the passage, God tells them that they're not to gather on the Sabbath day. They're not to go out and gather on the Sabbath day. If you skip way down to verse 22, it explains, it came to pass that on the sixth day, they gathered twice as much bread, two omers, an omer was about 2 liters, for one man, and all the rulers of the congregation came and told Moses. He said unto them, this is that which the Lord has said, tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Bake that which ye will bake today, and seethe that ye will seethe, and that which remaineth over lay up for you to be kept until the morning. They laid it up till the morning, as Moses bade, and it did not stink, which happened previously in the chapter. Those that neglected it, they didn't go out and gather it. They gathered too much, or they left it until the morning. Verse 20, it says, notwithstanding, they hearkened not unto Moses, but some of them left of it until the morning, and it bred worms and stank. And Moses was wroth with them. But here, you might think, man, they knew that if they didn't go get that manna when they were supposed to, that it was going to melt or it was going to rot and stink, and they better get going. So when God said, but don't go on the Sabbath day, they would have been tempted to say, well, I got to. But you've got to mix the word of God with faith. That's what Hebrews tells us concerning salvation. Hebrews says there were some of them that they heard the word, but they didn't mix it with faith, so it wasn't profitable. They didn't understand salvation because they didn't mix it with faith. You've got to mix the word with faith and obedience, or it isn't going to do you any good. It just goes in one ear and out the other. And so God explains that you got to trust me, mix my word with faith, and do what I say, and then I'll bless the word. I'll bless the word. And so that manna, this must have been mind-boggling for the children of Israel. It's like, wow. And God did this for 40 years. He showed them that manna lasts on the Sabbath. Any other day of the week, it won't last 2 days. But on the Sabbath, it will last. And that's how it is for the working man today. He said, oh, I can't take that Sunday off. You got to mix God's word with faith. You got to trust God and go and worship God and put him first. And God will bless. God will bless. And so, is it time to read that? So it gives those that obeyed God, and the word in the manna did not stink. But then there were some, well, we read this now, verse 27, came to pass that there went out some of the people on the seventh day for to gather, and they found none. All the rest of the week, the manna just rained down all around them, and they just go out and gather up all the manna. But because they didn't go by faith and obedience to God, they go out on the Sabbath day. The seventh day, they can't find any manna. You think that would kind of, the first time they tried that, would be like, I guess I better start obeying the word of God. It says in verse 28, and the Lord said unto Moses, how long refuse ye to keep my commandments and my laws? Moses must have been like, I have to take some of the blame for this. I guess I should have really stressed this, really preached this hard. It says, see, for that the Lord hath given you the Sabbath, therefore he giveth you on the sixth day the bread of 2 days. Abide ye every man in his place, let no man go out of his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day. And so the word of God has to be mixed with faith and obedience. And Jesus said, he that will do my will, how did the Lord say that? You know that verse? He that will do my will shall know of my doctrine. Is that how it says that? Turn to John chapter 7. It's like, you're not going to understand things of the Lord if you don't mix faith and obedience with God's word. It's just not going to happen, because God will measure out more to those that hear and those that obey, and he's going to take it away from those that won't hear and won't obey. It's a principle in God's word. And John chapter 7, verse 16, Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. So the Lord is saying, if you obey what you know, then you'll learn more. But if you disobey what you know, you're not going to learn anymore, and you're going to lose it. It's going to be taken away from you. And that's how it was with the manna. When they didn't gather it when God said to gather it, or when they didn't not gather it when God said not to gather it, they suffered for it. The same way in the Christian life today is so obvious. Back to Exodus 16. Let me see how many more. Interesting. There's so many interesting things you can learn from this chapter. In verse 6, it says, and Moses and Aaron said unto all the children of Israel, at even, then ye shall know that the Lord hath brought you out from the land of Egypt. Now, interesting point number 8, sweetie. You're getting all these, you got to be writing fast tonight. Writing fast. The word of God helps us to recognize God's leading. The word of God, the manna, as they were going to eat the manna, it's going to help them with their murmurings, their desire to go back to Egypt. It's going to help them to wake up and to realize that it's the Lord that brought them out of Egypt. Eating God's word helps you to realize what God's done in your life, his direction, his leading. There's so many great things about the word of God. Number nine, the word of God. Maybe, sweet, what you got to do is put the little, what do you call these things here? Quotation marks. So you don't have to write out that, you know, the word of God. She's got this anyway. She's good. She takes great notes. Okay, so when I can't find my notes, I say, you got that notes on that message? So this is really good. This is really good. Number 9, the word of God reveals God's glory. It shows us who he is. Look at verse 7. It says, in the morning, then ye shall see the glory of the Lord. So God's saying, I'm going to give you manna. You got to go out and gather it up. You know, those that aren't going to go gather it up and they're not going to seek the Lord, they're going to miss out on this. You gather the manna up, you see how God provides for you and just how good he is. You're going to see the glory of the Lord. The word of God, as you get into God's word and read it and pray for God to help you to understand it, you get to see the glory of the Lord. And the end of verse 10, it says, behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. Verse 12, it says, I have heard the murmurings of the children of Israel. Speak unto them, saying, at evening ye shall eat flesh, and in the morning ye shall be filled with bread, and ye shall know that I am the Lord your God. You know. I remember as a young person, just when I got into Christian school and I started reading the Bible, learning the Bible for myself, and it's just like, this is amazing. This is, God is so amazing. When you get into the manna, you eat the manna, you eat the bread of God, you eat his word, then you see how great God is. You see his glory. And that's what happened as God gave his people manna. And man, oh man. Got lots on this list. Let's look at another one. Verse 14. It says, and when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness, there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoarfrost on the ground. Out here along the side of the building, it doesn't get a lot of sun there. It gets kind of muddy. And the frost will get into the mud right there. You've probably seen places like this when it just kind of raises it up and it just fills it. And you walk on it. And just all this frost. And you might think of frost, it's just frost. Whatever, frost. You know that there's areas of the world that if it wasn't for the dew and the frost, that a lot of plant life wouldn't even survive. They don't get a lot of rain. And it's the dew and the frost that they survive through the dew and the frost. And somebody might look at the word of God and say, oh, you know, it might appear as an insignificant thing. I'm sure the world, you know, the world just looks at the Bible like, that's not important. But we know how important it is. The word of God may seem small and insignificant, but it is life-giving and life-changing, and it reveals the plan of salvation. It's the difference between heaven and hell. And let's stop with this one. It's so hard to stop with these are like, I like them. Number 11. Look at verse 15. And when the children of Israel saw it, they said one to another, it is manna. And manna means, what is this? What is this? For they wist not what it was. They look at this all over, everywhere. This white looks like frost. And then, what is this? And Moses said unto them, this is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. And the principle here, number 11, is the word of God must be explained by God. The word of God is Moses, the prophet, who gets the word from God, told them, this is from God. This is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. And isn't that how it is when we come to the Bible? When we eat the manna of God's word? It's like, we got to have God. Otherwise, what is this? And the key, we know the key to the scriptures is Jesus. He's the key. And then he just explains, well, this is what this is. This is what this is talking about. And a lot of times you're reading the Bible and it just sends a chill down your spine like, wow, wow. God is so amazing. God is so great. So the manna, bread from heaven for you. Bread from heaven for you. We'll stop right there.